Hello, good morning everybody. Now today's lecture on the development of the central nervous system. The central nervous system is derived from the neural tube, and neural tube is derived from the neural groove, which is derived from the neural plate. Now this neural plate is derived from the surface ectoderm cells, surface ectoderm, which overlies the notochordal process or notochord. Now this is the PRSF jarndyx showing the prochordal plate at the cranial end. This is the sleeper shape neural plate, which is derived from the surface ectoderm. Under surface neuroectoderm, we get the notochordal process. Then this is the primitive knot. This is a primitive streak, and this is cloacal membrane, and that is the connecting stalk. Now this is a transverse section of the PRSF jarndyx. This is the surface ectoderm. This is endoderm. These are mesoderms. And in between the mesoderm, that is the paraxymesoderm, we get the notochord. Because of the presence of the notochord, this much surface ectoderm cell becomes neuroectoderm, and this neuroectoderm, they form the neural plate. Now at the end of the neural plate, there is a neuroectodermal junction that is called neural crest. Now this plate becomes groove. This is the neural groove. The neural groove becomes neural tube. When this neural groove becomes neural tube, then we get the release of the neural crest cell. Okay. Now the central nervous system appears at the beginning of the third week of intermediate life as a sleeper shaped plate of the thickened ectoderm. That is known as neural plate in the mid dorsal region in front of the primitive knot. With the further development, the neural folds continue to elevate and approach each other in the midline and finally fuse, forming the neural tube. Then this fusion of the neural tube begins in the cervical region, then proceed in the cephalic and caudal direction. Once the fusion is initiated, the open ends of the neural tube form the cranial, that is anterior, and caudal, that is posterior, neuropores that communicates with the overlying amniotic cavity. Now, final closure of the cranial neuropores, that is anterior neuropores, occurs at the 18 to 20 somite stage, that is 25th day, or at the beginning of the fourth week. The caudal neuropores, that is the posterior neuropore, closes on the 28th day, that is at the end of fourth week, or the 25th somite stage. In the adult, the posterior neuropores represent the terminal ventricles. Okay. Now, anterior neuropores, it fuses at the 18 to 20 somite stage or the 25th day or the beginning of the fourth week, while the posterior neuropores, which closes on 28th day or at the end of fourth week or the 25th somite stage. Now this is the dorsal view of the human embryo showing this neural groove at the 22nd and 23rd stage of the embryo. Now this is the neural groove which begins to fuse at the cervical region, then proceed to cranial and caudally. This is the anterior or the cranial neuropores, which is closest at the 20th somate stage or at the beginning of the fourth week. This is the posterior or the caudal neuropores, which fuses at the 25th somatic stage or at the end of the fourth week. Now, differentiation of the neural tube. Neural tube present a central cavity and a peripheral wall. Now, the central cavity represents the ventricles of the brain and the central canal of the spinal cord. From the wall of the neural tube, the various cells of the central and the peripheral nervous system develops. Now, separation of neural crest cells. At the time of the formation of the neural plate, some cells at the junction of the neural plate with the and surface ectoderm become specialized to form the primordia of the neural crest. With the closure of the neural tube and restoration of the surface ectoderm, the neural crest cells form the bilateral masses along the dorsolateral aspect of the neural tube deep to the surface ectoderm. These neural crest cells become free and migrate to the distant places throughout the body. The cells, the neural crest cells, they are divided into dorsal mass and the ventral mass. Now, derivative of the neural crest cells. Now, first, derivative of the dorsal mass. The neural crest cell divided into dorsal mass and ventral mass. Now, the first derivative of the dorsal mass, a neuroblast cells. From the dorsal mass, we get the neuroblast cells, spongiblast cells, and the pluripotent cells. Now, the neuroblast cell. Neuroblast cells, which form the pseudo unipolar neurons of dorsal root ganglion of the spinal nerve. They also form the neurons of the sensory ganglion of 5th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th cranial nerves. Now, B, spongioblast cells, which form the capsular or the stellate cells of all the sensory ganglion. Schwann cells that form the neurolemma and the myelin sheath of all the peripheral nerves. Now, C, pluripotent cells, which form the mesenchymes of the dental papilla. They also form the odontoblast and the dentin. Now, melanoblasts, which form the pigment cell of the skin. In cartilage cells of the branchial arches, they are also formed by the pluripotent cells. And the leptomeninges, that is the pyometer and the arachnoid matter, they derive from the pluripotent cells. Now, derivative of the ventral mass. Ventral mass, they convert into the sympathoblast cells, that is small cell, and chromaffin cells, or the large cells. Now, from the sympathoblast cells, we get neurons of the sympathetic ganglion, the neurons of the peripheral parasympathetic ganglion of the cranial nerve, that is 3rd, 7th, 9th, and 10th. Now, chromaffin cells, the large cells, which develop into the suprarenal medulla, medullary part of the adrenal gland, paraotic body, argentiferine cells, and the enterochromaffin cells or APUD cells. Now, other structure which is believed to be arise from the neural crest cells. First, with the bones of the face and the part of the vault of skull. Muscles of ciliary body of the eye, sclera and the choroid of the eye, substantia propria and the posterior epithelium of the cornea, Then we get the derivatives of the first, second, and third pharyngeal cartilage. C cell of the thyroid is also formed by the neurocrescents. Now, diagram showing the ways derivative of the neurocrescent. First, neurocrescent divided into dorsal mass and the ventral mass. Now, from the dorsal mass, we get the neuroblast cells, spongiblast cells, and the pluripotent cells. From these all cells, we get this melanoblast cell, which form a pigment cell of the skin. Then, capsular cell or striate cell, which are the cells of the sensory ganglion. Leptomeninges, which form the pyometer and arachnoid matter. And the Schwann cell, which form the myelin sheath of the neurulemma or the myelin sheath of the of peripheral nerves. Then these are the ventral mass. First, the ventral mass cell divided into symphalangblast cells, that is small cell, and the chromatin cells, that is large cell. We develop into the sympathetic neurons, ganglion, middle of the adrenal gland, paraortic bodies. It also forms the ganglion of the 3rd, 7th, 9th, and 10th cranial nerve. Now, the development of brain in short. The cephalic end of the neural tube shows three dilations, that is known as primary brain vesicles. They are prosencephalon, which form the forebrain, mesencephalon, which form the midbrain, and rhombencephalon, that form the hindbrain. Prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and the rhombencephalon are at the first arranged craniocaudally. The relative position is greatly altered by the appearance of a number of the flexures or the curvatures. There are four flexures which appears at a developing brain. The first one is cervical flexure, second cephalic, it is also known as mesencephalic flexure, then pontine flexure and telencephalic flexure. First one, cervical, which appears at the junction of the rhombencephalon and the spinal cord. It is concave ventrally. It makes an angle of 90 degrees between the hindbrain and the spinal cord. The cephalic, that is mesencephalic flexure, it appears in the midbrain region. It is concave ventrally. Then pontine flexure, it is at the middle of the rhombencephalon, dividing it into the cranial metencephalon part and the caudal, that is myelencephalon. It is convex ventrally, and this flexure changes the shape of this part of the tube. Now, lastly, telencephalic flexure, it occurs much later between the telencephalon and the diencephalon. Now, this diagram showing the various vesicles and the flexures of the brain. This is the cranial part of the neural tube. This is caudal part, which is narrow. Cranial part showing the three bulging, that is prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and the rhombencephalon. Then we get the four flexures, which is cervical flexure, mesencephalic, pontine flexure, and telencephalic flexure. First one, cervical flexure, which appears at the junction of the rhombencephalon and the spinal cord, which is concave ventrally. And lies between the, make an angle between the hindbrain and the spinal cord. The second flexure, that is the mesencephalic flexure, it is also known as cephalic flexure, which appears in the region of the midbrain, which is again concave ventrally. Third flexure, that is pontine flexure, which appear in the region in the middle of the rhombencephalon, which is convex ventrally, and divide the mesencephalon into two parts, metencephalon and myelencephalon. The four flexa, that is telencephalic flexa, which appear in the prosencephalon and divide the prosencephalon into the telencephalon and the diencephalon. Now this is the cranial part of the neural tube, which having the prosencephalon, mesencephalon and rhombencephalon from cranial caudal. Okay. These three, they are divided into various part. This rhombencephalon we divide into metencephalon and myelencephalon. Mesencephalon, it forms the midbrain, while the prosencephalon is divided into telencephalon and the diencephalon. There are two right and left vesicles of the telencephalon, which develop into two hemispheres, right and left, and this middle part is the diencephalon. The cavity of the, this is the primitive cavity of the cranial part of the neural tube. Now this two, these are two hemispheres, right and left, and the cavity of the hemisphere, cerebral hemisphere, is from a lateral ventricle. The cavity of the diencephalon is forming the third ventricle, and the cavity of the midbrain or mesencephalon, which is narrow, remains narrow, that forming cerebral aqueduct. Then cavity of the rhombencephalon, which form the fourth ventricle. Now by the 5th week's development, the primary brain vesicles have differentiated into 5 secondary vesicles. The prosencephalon is divided into telencephalon and diencephalon, mesencephalon and rhombencephalon, which again divided into metencephalon and myelencephalon. Now the cavity of the brain vesicles. Each of the divisions of the developing brain vesicles is a part of the original cavity of the neural tube. Encloses the part of the original cavity of the neural tube. The cavities in the relation with the various brain vesicles form the ventricular system of the adult brain. The cavity of the telencephalic vesicle becomes the lateral ventricles, and the cavity of the diencephalon, which form the third ventricle. Cavity of mesencephalon, which remains narrow and form the aqueduct of Sylvius. The cavity of the rhombencephalon form the fourth ventricle, while the cavity of the spinal cord, primitive spinal cord, which form the central canal of the spinal cord. Now this is the prosencephalon, this is mesencephalon, this is rhombencephalon. Now prosencephalon is divided into telencephalon and the diencephalon. There are two telencephalic vesicles which form the right and left cerebral hemisphere, and the cavity of the telencephalon is that form the lateral ventricle. Now this is diencephalon, which form thalamus, hypothalamus and pituitary gland, and the cavity of the diencephalon is the third ventricle. Now this is the mesencephalon, which form the midbrain, and the cavity of the mesencephalon that form a cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. This is the rhombencephalon, which divide into metencephalon and the myelencephalon. Metencephalon, which form the cerebellum and the pons, and the myelencephalon, which form the medulla oblongata, and the cavity of this rhombencephalon that form the fourth ventricle. Now development of the spinal cord. The spinal cord develops from the caudal narrow part of the neural tube. The spinal cord develops from the caudal cylindrical part of the neural tube. When this caudal part of the neural tube is first formed, its cavity is in the form of a dorsoventral cleft. This cavity, that is dorsoventral cleft, having two lateral walls, one roof, one floor. Now the lateral walls are thick, but roof or dorsal wall, and the floor or the ventral wall, they are thin. Then the wall of the neural tube is subdivided into ependymal or matrix of the matrix cell layer, second that is mantle layer, and third one is the marginal layer. Now wall of the closed neural tube consists of the neuroepithelial cells. These cells extend over the entire thickness of the wall and form a thick pseudo stratified epithelium. Once the neural tube closes, the neuroepithelial cells begin to give rise to another cell type. These cells are the primitive nerve cells. It is also known as neuroblast cells. They form the mantle layer, that is zone around the neuroepithelial layer. The mantle layer later forms the gray matter of the spinal cord. The gray matter is nothing but this cell body of the neurons. In the outermost layer of the spinal cord, that is the marginal layer, which contains the nerve fibers emerging from the neuroblast cells in the mantle layer. That's why we get three layers in the neural tube. That is the first layer, that is the ependymal cell which line the neural tube cavity. Second layer, that is the mantle layer, which consists of the neurons, cell body of the neurons that form the gray matter of the spinal cord. And third, marginal layer, which contain the nerve fibers which emerging from the neuroblast cells in the mantle layer. As a result of the myelination of the nerve fibers, this layer takes on a white appearance and therefore is called white matter of the spinal cord. Okay, the marginal layer contains the nerve fiber. On myelination, it becomes white. That's why that known as white matter of the spinal cord. Now this is the basement membrane and this is the luminal part, lumen of the, here again the lumen of this neural tube. Now these are the cells that is known as pseudostratified epithelium. They line the neural tube, which divide and form the mantle layer. Mantle layer mainly consists of the neuroblast cells, which form the neurons. And this nerve fiber arising from these nerve cells, they need to form the marginal layer. Now the basal, alar, roof and the floor plates of the neural tube. As a result of continuous addition of the neuroblast cell to the mantle layer, each side of the neural tube shows a ventral and dorsal thickening. Ventral thickenings are known as basal plates, which contain the ventral motor horn cells. Motor horn cells form the motor areas of the spinal cord. The second thickening, that is dorsal thickenings, are known as alar plates, which form the sensory areas. Now this is the primitive neural tube. It consists of the three layers. First one, the ependymal layer or matrix cell layer. Then we get the mantle layer, which consists of the neurons. And lastly, marginal layer, this white one, the marginal layer. Now there are two longitudinal grooves which appear in the central canal, which divide the wall of the neural tube into ventral thickenings and then dorsal thickenings. Now the ventral thickenings which form the basal plate and dorsal thickening which form the alar plate. This is the roof and this is the plate. Dorsal part, that is the roof part, and this is ventral part, is the floor part. They are thin parts. They don't contain the neurons or neuroblast cells. This is the central canal, which is lined by the ependymal cells. Okay, the basal plate, which form the ventral horn, which contain the motor neuron, and this alar plate, or the dorsal thickening, which form the dorsal horn, which contain the sensory neurons. This is the roof part and this is the floor part. This part don't contain the neurons. They serve as a passage for the nerve fibers. Now we have seen in the diagram, that is the longitudinal groove, that is known as sulcus limitans, which mark the boundary between the basal and the alar plates. The dorsal and the ventral midline portion of the neural tube, known as roof and floor plate respectively, they do not contain the neuroblast cells. They serve primarily as a pathway for the nerve fiber crossing from one side to another. In addition to the ventral motor horn and dorsal sensory horn, a group of neurons accumulates between the two areas, that is motor area or sensory area, and form a small intermediate horn. This horn, containing the neurons of sympathetic portion of the autonomic nervous system, is present only at the thoracic and the upper lumbar region, upper lumbar levels of the spinal cord. Now, histological differentiation of the neural tube. First, nerve cells. Neuroblasts, or the primitive nerve cells, arise exclusively by the division of the neuroepithelial cells. In glial cell, they are the supporting cell. The majority of the primitive supporting cells, known as glial blast cells, are formed by the neuroepithelial cells after the production of the neuroblast seizures. Glioblasts migrate from the neuroepithelial layer to the marginal layer of the primitive spinal cord. Now, this is about the development of the CNS in short. CNS derived from the surface ectoderm, that is neuroectoderm, which is because of the presence of the notochord. Some part of this surface ectoderm get converted into the neuroectoderm, which form the neural plate, the neural tube, then this cranial part of neural tube behind that form the vesicles, three brain vesicles that develop into the brain, and the caudal narrow part, which form the spinal cord. Okay, thank you for listening.